Okay, we're back. We are back. Donovan Sadiq, Tay Wilder, yes, right. And you are listening to Lovin' the Skin I'm In. And we're going to be talking about Lovin' the Skin that we're in. And we're just kind of talking about image and objections and objectification of women. So let's don't freestyle much, but I write them like such. So, in conclusion with this guy, I mean, so if he doesn't meet the criteria that he meets, why would he expect you to be this?
But that's the double standard. Mm-hmm. That's the double standard. A lot of people set the bar for an expectation that they want. And I don't understand why. Why would you expect someone to have something that you don't? And then if I say, well, okay, you don't have these things. Mm-hmm. So, and I understand that everybody wants somebody that brings something to the table, right? Okay. You know? And I think what I am wanting isn't a lot, but I think it's probably too much for the area that I live in. You know what I'm saying?
What's your ideal man? If you were looking for a man right now, like you guys asked me when we first started this, what is my ideal woman? And I was all over the place. So what is your ideal person? Six pack abs, no. Braids down to the no. thing, thugging tattoos.
Oh no.
Sagging like pants to his knees.
Oh god no. I like a clean cut gent.
Okay.
Because I'm a
sure. You're a professional woman, so.
I don't want anybody it's the flashy thing doesn't do anything for me. A clean cut person that's, you know, grounded, family oriented, that's, you know, motivated, you know, and driven.
Okay. But physically.
Physically, you know what? It's so random. It's so
fat
random.
Guy.
It doesn't.
Have you ever dated a fat guy?
I have dated a fat guy.
Now, when I say fat, Tay, no, I mean fat. Was, not like, he was 6'1", 170.
No, he was a fat guy. I'll show you the picture later. Okay. He was a fat guy.
Okay.
He was a fat guy.
And why didn't that relationship work out? Or that dating situation?
It was more of a distance thing because he lived in Victorville and I lived.
That's only 40 minutes away. I was like going to L.A.
Yeah, but still.
What? That's him? What? Go ahead, girl. Now, I don't know if he could reach his thing, but, I mean, he could? Okay, yeah. All right, hey, yeah, hey, okay, hey, it is what it is. Yeah, so.
No, but he has beautiful eyes, he has beautiful teeth.
He's a very handsome guy.
He had a great career, and he's well-traveled, he had a great career.
This is the forklift operator or the
no he was a no almost said his name but he about no he is he was not that mechanic okay. but he is a mechanic
okay gotcha.
But he's a mechanic but he also has a heavy electrician background
sure.
So you know he's ooh, multifaceted sweet. It's sweet isn't it sweet no but he's really guys we're still friends to this day I'm friends
with benefits?
No, okay. No, I'm never that girl.
For those that are listening, Tay hits it and quits it and she's done.
Yeah, I'm never she said, that girl. I'm never that girl.
Okay, gotcha. Gotcha.
No, I'm for the most part, I'm friends with all my exes. I'm friends with my ex-husband. I'm friends with the majority of my exes.
Why not?
I mean, if it's not that deep, then cool.
Right. I mean, it is what it is and you guys move on and stay friends.
Yeah.
Like it should be.
Yeah, I mean, just because we didn't stay together in a relationship doesn't mean that we have to stop. Because our foundation starts off in a friendship. So why would that stop?
So the romantic part was he attracted to you because of your skin? Or?
Oh, he. If you let him tell it, yeah.
Was it?
Yeah.
Were you his first woman of color?
No.
Well, he's a man of color himself, so.
That was strictly his lane.
Oh, okay.
That is strict. But I was the lightest girl he ever dated.
Well, you know what they say: the darker the berry, the sweeter the juice. So you know, so you would be kind of tart.
Yeah, you know, and it's funny because like my sister's chocolate, the one that's married, she's chocolate. Mm-hmm. Her husband's Mexican, so they have beautiful babies.
Beautiful babies.
Me and my sister are light. Like my youngest sister, she's lighter than me. Mm-hmm. So it's. When people like look at us, they're like, "What's going on?
What happened here?" Yeah.
No, it's I've always wanted to be darker because my sister's darker, and I love that cocoa skin.
The cocoa skin, exactly. It's beautiful.
You know, I follow this this model on Instagram, and her name is Melanin Goddess, and she is so black, and she is so beautiful, and she's from Africa, and her skin is insane. I've never seen anybody with such beautiful dark skin. But again, a lot of people don't, they want, you know, what's light is supposed to be right, you know, and they go, and a lot, and I'm not saying everybody, but you know, people like, you know, the light skin, long hair, you know, that's just their
thing. You know, don't get me wrong, and this is my personal opinion. I've dated some light skin women. My first wife was hazel eyed, like yourself, and light skin. And
see, my sister has gray eyes.
Gray eyes. Okay.
So what throws a lot of people, they see this, you know, because her hair is natural and it's just wild and carefree. And, you know, she's got, you know, small waist and she's got the hips and she's got, she's lighter than me and she's got these big greenish gray eyes. Right. And everyone's like, yo, yo, what's up?
Right.
And I mean, it will be, it's like, it's kind of creepy because, like, we went to, we were in Marina Del Rey a couple weeks ago and we were literally walking from valet to the doors of the hotel, and it was like, dudes was like, hey, 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 hey. And I was like, God, I've never had that kind
Not
to her.
How do you know they weren't doing it to you?
To her.
How do you know they weren't doing it to you?
I know they weren't doing it to me.
How do you know that?
Because they were talking to her.
Okay. I'll take your word for it. I wasn't there.
My sister is a beautiful girl. She really is. Mm-hmm. And she, and the sad part is she knows she's beauty. So she's resting on pretty.
Pretty.
And everyone keeps telling her, you can't rest on pretty forever.
Right.
And I think...
How old is she?
25, 26?
Oh, yeah. No. She, you know, she has another maybe, you know, a 7, 8...
No, she'll be 27 this year. So 26.
Okay. So she has another maybe 12, 15 years to run on that.
But, you know, I'm... skin is good. My grandma was 78 when she, and her skin was fabulous.
Fabulous.
I mean, not a wrinkle, nothing. My grandma looked so good. My dad's mom looked so good. She was 78 when she died.
Okay.
You know, unfortunately, it was cancer that took her. But
fairly young.
Even when she was going through it, her skin was flawless. My grandma always told me, you know, I was the only girl for a long time in my family. And she always told me, you don't have to wear all the makeup.
Yeah, there's some people that are like that. They're blessed.
Because, you know, back in the, you know, the 50s, 60s, they wore the falsies. Mm-hmm. And they wore, you know, but my grandma always
go-go boots and all that.
Yeah, I didn't have to. She goes, you don't have to do all that.
Right, right.
She said, you just don't have to do
all that. Yeah, and then that's why it's hard for me to believe that you're having all the unsuccess.
Because people want that. And I don't do that. I won't do weaves. I don't need to do a weave.
Yeah, you don't. Your hair is beautiful.
I can grow my own hair.
Right.
This is all me, you know? I don't need to wear a whole lot of... Today, I literally have nothing but mascara on today. You know, I'll wear mascara and lip gloss.
Yeah.
I don't need... I just...
Well, remember that time you came to the radio show and we were like, kept looking like, God, what, you know, where are you going? What's going on?
Oh, because I wore makeup that day.
Yeah, I was like, whoa.
Yeah, we had...
not that it was a significant difference, but you can tell that you looked...
Yeah, when... when you see me, like, dress, is when I have, when we have clients
coming in the house and stuff like
that. Yeah, when we have, like, a big meeting, then I'll go ahead and I'll slap some makeup on, you know. But other than that, I don't have to.
So let me ask you this. I hate to change the subject, but I think this is important for people that listen. And we're a positive show. As a professional, what advice would you give young girls, young ladies that are, like, you know, trying to get into the business world and they don't... they're not really paying attention to their appearance. Like, good example, I've got this big Wonder Woman tattoo on the middle of my chest, and I'm a woman, but I want to be in the business world.
See, okay, like my last job, and even this job, I still have the privilege of interviewing people, and I have had to, I have let a lot of candidates go.
Good candidates.
Good candidates.
Right.
Education.
Right. Flawless. Experience. Everything's good.
Everything spot on. You know, they have, you know, they're working on their MBA, they're doing this, they have,
What was it that made you say, even though you have all that and you're great, spectacular, but, I mean, what is it about the appearance of that you couldn't overlook? What was it about it?
And today, if you're trying to walk into a corporate setting, the one thing you cannot do is walk in with, you know, rainbow, you know, brightly colored hair, extremely long nails. If you're not presenting yourself in a professional manner, we have girls that come with excessive cleavage, or, you know, I don't even mind if you wear, you know, if you wear a nice fitted, a tight pencil skirt, but still make sure that you balance that out where you don't look like you're going to the club.
Right. All right.
And I think a lot of people mistake, you know, sexy and professional. It's two totally different things. And I'm not saying dress like a nun.
Right.
But I'm saying that, you know, you can't show up for a job with, you know, neon green nails with, you know, or tattoos on your hands. Even though I have tattoos on my hand, on my fingers.
Right.
But again, no one, my
see, boss, if I'm looking at your hands, I couldn't even see your tattoos.
My boss didn't even know until I was like 5-6 months in. And he, I did something, and he goes, "Do you have a tattoo?" And I said, "Oh, it's a light. I have a lightsaber on my hand." And he was just like,
"Right."
And I was like, "Oh, I have a lot of tattoos, you know." And I do. I have a lot of tattoos, but again, you don't see them unless I show you them,
right?
Because when I was in the military, it was one of those things where you, you know,
you're representing an organization.
We had the rules,
right?
So I've learned to just hide them,
right?
So it's. It's sad, you know, because a lot of people just don't know how to dress to interviews. Like my last job, we had girls come in like pajama pants, leggings.
That's what I'm saying.
But
you
they're
know.
Not being taught these things. And I think that's stuff you learn but
who are
at
they?
Home or Google. Google is free.
Well, that's what I'm saying. TV, you can watch, see on TV. Power. I don't see what's her name dressing all.
Yeah, and I mean, I don't expect you to come in 4-inch heels. I don't even wear 4-inch heels unless I have like a corporate meeting going on.
Okay.
You know, I don't expect you to come in, you know, in 4-inch
heels. So you wouldn't recommend me coming in there with fire engine red hair, even though I'm dark skinned black girl, or blue hair, purple hair. No tattoos on my chest, and if I have it on my chest, cover up.
Cover up. I mean, or you know.
No flip flops.
I always tell people, if you're going to come in, don't wear a whole bunch of club makeup, because you'll see girls come in here with their face like a full beat
clown.
And not even that. And it's like, where are you going? Why do you have 301 lashes on at 9 o'clock in the morning?
Right.
This is not the club.
Right, but you want to be taken seriously in a professional setting.
But people misconstrue, you know, the professional with... But Coco Chanel had a quote that if you look at yourself in the mirror, take one thing off. And I do that every day. I'll get dressed for work and I'm like, you know what? I think this may be a little too much, so I'll go ahead, you know. But some people don't know how to edit. The power of editing makes is something that is a learned is something that's learned, and you learn it over time. And if you've never been taught to edit, then you won't know when too much is too much.
Right. Let me ask you this. And we're on a professional side real quick. We had you just met a young man that is trying to better himself. He's 25 years old. He's trying to get out of Moreno Valley. He doesn't want to work in a warehouse. He wants to get out of here. Unfortunately, you know, his mom is at that point where, look, you're 25 years old. You got to go.
But see, that's her fault that she let him get that far. I've been telling both my boys. My son just turned 18 in January.
He ain't going nowhere. No, I'm joking.
Well, you know what? My son is on the spectrum, so I don't. Sure. I don't. And I know not every child is going to. No one's going to be. I left at 18 and haven't looked back.
Right.
I know everybody's not like that. If my son's going to go to college, then fine. Go to college. I'd rather you.
You're
stay
doing
home,
something.
Go to school. Get your focus on your education and not incur any
and
debt.
And what you
want
right.
to
do. And what you want to do. Get yourself ready. Set yourself up.
And that was something I learned, you know, but, you know, no wives, no girlfriends, ain't nobody moving in, because this ain't no, it's not a hostel.
Ain't no grandbabies, right.
No, none of that. I think that we do a disservice to our children when we don't push them to figure out who they want to be.
Okay.
And I know that what I wanted to be at 18 is not who I wanted to be at
35. Right.
And it's not who I want to be at 40. So it's...
Not everybody's going to be a rapper.
And that's the thing. We need to give our kids...
Realistic.
Attainable goals. Right. Not everybody's going to make it in the music industry. Not everybody's
going to be a dancer.
Not everybody's going to be an actor. Not everybody's going to be a filmmaker, producer, whatever it is.
Right, whatever it is you do.
But if you focus on this craft and you go to school, you know, you go to film school, you do whatever.
Sure.
Have a plan A and a plan B. And when you start your plan A, you may get into it and realize that this is where... I've said that before, that I started out as a nurse. And I realized as I got into it, while I love helping and taking care of people, patient care wasn't my thing. it was a little bit more than I thought it was going to be.
Right.
So I said, okay, I redirected, and I said, okay, well...
And you also read yourself.
Right, and I said, okay, midwifery. And I love being a midwife.
Mm.
And while I don't do it like I used to,
right,
it's still something that I, if my friends call, you know, and I have to go and do my state license and all
but,
California. But if my friends call and say, hey, I want, like, my girlfriends and all that other fun stuff, you know, when I did in Japan and Georgia and all this other fun stuff, fine, I'll go ahead and, you know, I'll do it. But I know where, and again, but it took something, it took some time to figure out what I wanted to be.
Sure.
And once I fell in love with my career field in the military, I knew that this was where, this was my lane.
Right. That's,
and I took it.
That's going to pay the bills and do with it, right.
And it not just pay the bills, because I don't want to be a, I don't want to have a job that I didn't enjoy.
Enjoy, love, right.
And my dad loves what he does. Mm-hmm. My mom loves,
I love what I did.
My mother's a math wizard, and she loves working in banking. She's worked in banking since I, before I was born. My dad has worked in transportation since before I was born. And they love what they do. And that's what my family has always told me. My granddad was a truck driver forever, and he loved being on the road. That was, he worked for Blue Diamond forever, and he loved it. You know,
was he long haul or short haul?
He did both.
Okay.
He did both. Okay. He did short haul in the beginning while the kids were small, and then as my dad and my brother, his brothers got older, then he transitioned to long haul.
He's like, I gotta get out of here. See y'all in a week.
He's a teenage boy. But you know, he was home just in time to whoop some ass and keep
going.
Right,
exactly. Exactly.
But you know, it's just one of those things where, you know, we as people, we evolve all the time.
Sure.
And we're, you know, our goals are, you know, short-term, long-term are always changing.
Okay, you know, what I want to say is, and I want to be specific to our culture in general, African-American, well, black American, I hate saying African-American.
Negroes.
Yeah, Negroes, coloreds, whatever. It's like this young man, you know, I'm glad you kind of talked to him because you kind of gave him an education of what I've been trying to reinforce. Because it's funny that, like, when one person says it, no matter how successful that person is, they don't believe you.
You know, I actually had this conversation. And, you know, actually, it was D.
D, with D? Okay.
It was D. And it was the Facebook thing, the Facebook Live. And I said, you know, the one thing about black people is we are hard-headed as hell.
Mm-hmm.
We really are. We think we know everything.
But we're on the bottom of the pile. But go ahead.
Exactly. But it's this thing where we think we know everything. We mistake arrogance for confidence.
Confidence, right.
And
yeah, people thought I was very arrogant.
And I tell people, I don't know everything.
Mm-hmm.
I may fake the funk, but I don't know everything. And if I don't know anything,
you'll ask.
I will tell you. Also, I'm sorry, what now? But that's where I think black people mess up. We don't take the time to, one, shut up
and listen.
And there's a difference between hearing you and listening to you. You know what I'm saying?
Because
you know, you've done Toastmasters, so you know about active and passive listening and all that stuff. So it's this thing where, you know, where we think we know it all, and we don't.
Nobody knows everything.
Because if we did, we would be in a better place. And we're not. And that's what's stopping the black community from having any type of unification.
Mm-hmm.
It's because we're all a bunch of chiefs, and no one wants to be the Indian. Because we're always so afraid that if we, you know, military, we learn leadership and we learn followership. That...
You have to be a good follower before you can be a good leader.
Exactly. And I think a lot of people don't learn. We teach our kids to always, you know, you got to win. You got to
stand
win,
up.
You got to go.
You first. Be the man, right.
Stick your chest out. Say it with your chest.
Right.
But we don't teach them that you do. You have humble beginnings.
Mm-hmm.
Not everyone starts off at the CEO. That's why it kills me when these people, when I see black people start businesses and it's just them and they're the CEO. Baby, who are you? Who are you?
Right. What corporation have you incorporated?
Yeah. Who are your people?
Would that apply?
How can you be a CEO of yourself?
Right. Well, would that apply to these pastors that are ordaining themselves bishops?
Yes.
Okay.
But again, now I'm not one. I will never slam another religion.
Mm-mm.
I won't. I won't slam religion at all.
No, no. It's not about slamming.
I think there are some wonderful things about religion. However, I do think that there are some people that follow certain leaders of big mega churches,
right? That prosperity preachers
are being conned.
Prosperity preachers,
exactly. That's, the Creflo Dollar. Okay, funny story. My ex-husband goes to Creflo Dollar Church.
Ha ha! White man in Creflo. Well, hey, it's all about green with Creflo Dollar.
He's literally the only one.
Right.
So, it's just one of those things where if I grandstand and tell you that God's going to deliver, blah 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 blah, y'all will throw money at me. Black people will throw money at me at heartbeat.
Right.
But if I tell you stop buying them Jordans, people will stand in line for Jordans before they'll stand in line for weave. A job.
Right, or weave.
They'll spend money on, you know, getting the best Indian Remy, whatever. Uh-huh. I don't know. I've never bought a weave in my life. But they won't invest in themselves.
They won't have the patience to wait for their hair to grow.
We have this problem with some black people are very materialistic.
Yes.
And I will say that, one, I am materialistic, mm-hmm. but I can afford it. So.
Hello.
But I make sure, one, my bills are paid. So I have roof, I have lights, I have hot water, I have food.
Food.
Mm-hmm. My children are taken care of, and then my cat is taken care of, my dog is taken care of, my turtle's taken care of, and then it's me. Mm-hmm. I'm always last on my list, because
there are
things that come before me.
Sure, but when it's time for you to splurge on yourself, you reward yourself.
Hell yeah!
Okay.
But again, a lot of black people put themselves before children.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's where we get the game messed up. Because if you look at any other community, you look at the Hispanic community, they are a very family-oriented community where it's all about family. Their kids will sit at home until they are 30 years old.
Right.
Because they want to make sure that, one, their kids are stable, that they're healthy, that they're happy, before they kick them out. Families, they will have 3-4 generations living in a compound.
Right.
Because
and voting.
And not just that, they're involved in the community, they have a family business, they're doing these things.
Right.
And we have, even the Jewish community, there's a Hasidic Jewish community off of Wilshire.
Mm-hmm.
And, Third and Fairfax.
Mm-hmm. Third and Fairfax, yeah.
And they have... you'll see their temple, and then they have business, family business, family business, family business, temple, family business, family business, family business. And I'm like, we don't do that. We don't invest in ourselves.
No.
We're so worried about having the nice
There's very few black businesses in the Moreno Valley itself.
Right. And
if there is a business, black business, it's a restaurant.
Right. A good restaurant.
Good restaurant, but restaurant.
There's nothing else. There's no, and like my girlfriend just started her own travel, she's a travel agent. And, you know, I try to support small business, period.
Sure, I do.
Mm-hmm. I can be called racist or whatever, but I do put black businesses before I put everyone else.
Of course, but that's socialism. That's a socialist.
But I want to see people prosper.
Right.
And I want to see my people prosper. I want to see Americans as a whole prosper, but I want to see those fledgling businesses prosper. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Like I said, if I see one more Mexican restaurant here in Moreno Valley, I'm going to pull what's left of my hair out.
Now we're popping up Vietnamese restaurants.
Yes, but we're, again, you're hitting on excellent topics, because people don't think about that. You got to look at your surroundings and say, how are we a third of the city? We don't have a third of a representation in anything.
But, I've always had... You know, I always go to black beauty salons, and, you know, now it's to the point where I have Persians do my hair.
Mm-hmm.
Persians do my eyebrows.
Sure.
They do Persians do my hair. They've got, even when I was overseas, it was, you know, Koreans, it was Asians. It was always somebody else other than black people doing my hair, because black people want to make it, instead of doing it and doing it at a level that's, you know, economical.
Sure.
For the area,
right.
It's always a little, it's a lot more.
Or what's that saying? Like I said, here's one thing, my aunt, she's a beautician. One thing that will never go out of style is women getting their hair done, no matter what the economy's imploding. Women will always get their hair done, or whatever the deal is.
But like out here, it was one girl, she was like, oh, okay, I'll do your hair for $150. I was like, girl, if I'm going to get my hair done in Moreno Valley for $150, I'm going to drive down that 91 and take my behind to L.A., where one, if I'm going to do for $150 for me, and my hair is literally 5 inches long, I'm going to Beverly Hills.
Right.
Because I know I'm getting all of the good expensive stuff.
See, and that brings up another topic. You know, we're not realistic in how we want to do it. My aunt's a beautician. She's always has money because her clientele follows her.
Mm-hmm.
You can't charge super duper prices starting out the gate and expect that clientele to stay with you. You've got to build your clientele. I'm not saying go on the cheap. We know what to try, but why is it that we always overcharge?
Because we're
and then the business fails because it's like, well, you anticipated Black people to shop there. Black people as a whole, we are great consumers. We consume mm-hmm. everything, mm-hmm. but we're not stupid either. I'll go to Walmart to get that hair product. If I can get it cheaper at Walmart.
I don't support Walmart. I don't support the Waltons at all.
No, I don't either. But what I was saying is, and what I'm saying is...
Yeah, no, people go to Walmart. Yeah. And that's what kills me, because I tell people all the time, I said, it's funny to me, because I can always tell when people get their tax refunds, because, like, I'll go, you know, to certain restaurants, and I don't see certain people there, and then tax time...
Exactly.
I see Black people showing up and showing out.
Right.
And I'm just like, can you take that tax return and put it into your savings? Invest in something.
See, and here's the thing. You bring that up. See, now, when I make observations like that, even on the other radio show, and I call that out, and I'll say, you know, there ain't no Black people here. You know, look around. I'll go on dinner, and I'll say, look how many Black people are in the place. I get called out, oh, you're hallucinating. No, this is real deal.
No, it's real. It's absolutely real. Because, okay, so here's the one thing. I am a people watcher. Mm-hmm. If you see me anywhere, if I'm sitting outside mm-hmm. and there's people around, I am
Did you see my Elizabeth Taylor?
Yeah, I am one that observes everything.
Right.
So the one thing, okay, and I live in an apartment because, one, I, with the current state of Moreno Valley, I decided to pull out of my realtor.
Well,
I'm not going to buy a house.
No, here's the deal.
I decided not to buy a house in Moreno Valley.
Okay, here's the deal. I can vouch. Tay can buy a house wherever she likes. She has that kind of income. So go ahead and continue.
Well, you know, I did look at a house.
Let me
tell you about this house in Riverside, though.
Tell me about it. So that we're going to be moving.
It was five bedroom, four and a half bedroom.
Sweetheart, we don't need five bedroom,
four and a half.
Sweetheart,
bathroom.
All we need is a two bedroom for you and our guests. That's all we need.
I have children.
They're going to be leaving soon.
I like guest room. Yeah. It was renovated kitchen. It was beautiful.
Beautiful.
Big backyard. Mm-hmm. It was 700. It was really cute for 700.
Mm-hmm. A month?
No, 700,000.
Oh, 700,000. Okay, gotcha. I'm sorry.
It was beautiful.
Is this off the 60?
No.
In that area? Okay.
It's in Riverside.
Okay.
It was so pretty. It had a beautiful farm. Okay, I am one that I love a good farm sink.
Sure.
I love a big, heavy sink. Mm-hmm. I love it. And it had beautiful built-ins. Mm-hmm. It had...
I need to take you to Pastor Don's house.
I heard Pastor Don has a house.
Yes.
But see, I saw another house in Paris, and I didn't... I have certain requirements. I hate saying I have certain requirements, only because I go to L.A. a lot, so this corridor is perfect for me. That's why I didn't move to Temecula, because I found a really nice condo in Harveston. It was $350. Mm-hmm. It was four bedroom, four bathroom, two car garage. The HOA fees were a little high, but it had a private lake. You can go fit. It's catch and release lake. And it was gated community. It was beautiful. Harveston is one of the most beautiful areas. It's just a gorgeous area.
Okay.
So, you know, my boss at work was helping me, you know, figure out where I was. Mm-hmm. And then there was another condo I looked at. It was a 3-2, it was a 3-3, and it was over by Pechanga, and it was really nice, but it was 331.
Okay.
It was a little too close to Pechanga, but the schools were great. But anyway.
Okay.
So I decided I'm not going to buy a house.
Okay. Not in Marina Valley, at least.
Well, to be honest, the election is what turned the tide for me.
Sure.
Because
it's over.
I'm more concerned about if I invest in Moreno Valley, what am I going to get out of it?
Nothing.
So I decided not to.
Sure.
I'm holding off until I figure out if I'm going to go back to Riverside or, you know, if I'm going to explore my...
Menifee or some other...
My workplace opportunities. Mm-hmm. Menifee's still too far down for me because I go to L.A. a lot. Mm-hmm. So if I move to L.A., it just depends on what my...
I understand.
I'm working with my job to figure out if I want to, you know, take an overseas job or move to L.A.
Right.
So I'm just trying to figure out what I want to do.
Skywalker Ranch, something like that. You never know.
You know, hey, if I'm lucky to get with Lucasfilm, I'll be great. But again, what are we talking about?
We're just talking about it.
Yeah, just rambling.
Yeah, we're just work. You know, we're workplaces and stuff like that.
It's. I like to see people prosper. Mm-hmm. I think that when people find success, it's great. Mm-hmm. It's just when people don't live. I see people with so much wonderful God-given talent.
Right, our people. Mm-hmm.
That and they don't. And they don't use it. They just wander it all away.
Well,
and I've just never understood that.
Well,
you know,
it's like with this young man that you met today. You know, here's this guy. He wants to do something with himself. But
I think
yet,
he's afraid.
Well, he's afraid, of course, but now his back's against the wall because he's pushed it to the limit. He's 25 years old, and his mom says he's got to leave the house. But at the same time...
Which is reasonable if he's doing nothing.
Yeah. But at the same time... I want to join the army. I want to go to this organization, but I'm still smoking weed. You know what I mean?
Yeah. And see, my whole thing
That's what I'm saying. We implode ourselves, and then we blame the white man or whatever man.
You can't blame the white man when you're doing it to yourself.
Exactly. And that's my point.
That's a scapegoat. You know, we can sit here and blame white people all day long, but at the end of the day, we are the captain and commander of our own ship.
Right.
You know, voluntarily smoke weed, and you... aren't your own business owner,
mm-hmm.
because then you don't have to report to
right.
anybody.
You don't have to report to anybody,
IRS.
And you can do what you
want
to do.
You can do what you want, right. But if you work for someone else...
And you're joining an organization, they have their rules.
Especially some that's a federal or state thing, mm-hmm. what do you expect?
Right.
But again, I think it's the lack of knowledge, mm-hmm. and it's a lack of training and conversations in the home.
But here's the thing. You know, he's sitting there telling me, oh, my mom said, you know, I don't want you to join the Air Force or the Navy, but I want you to join the Army. I said, well, first thing I asked him was, was your mom has military experience? No, she just thinks that would be better for me. Why would your mom want you to join the Army, the Marine Corps, and then you end up in Afghanistan somewhere and get killed?
I told you that know-it-all mentality. We think we know.
Exactly.
We think we know.
Exactly.
The first thing I tell anybody when they talk, oh, you know, I want to join the military. Mm-hmm. Okay, one, what do you like to do? Are you a technical person?
That's what I asked him.
Are you a hands-on person?
I said, what are you going to get out of it?
And he has. And that's sad because there's no reason, rhyme or reason, for anybody to be in their mid-20s and still not having any idea
what you want to do in life.
Not even that. I asked him, what are your passions? What motivates you? What do you like to do?
Mm-hmm.
And he couldn't tell me anything. What do you do? We all have something we like to do. I like to take my ass down to the Getty.
Right.
And I love to observe art all day.
Now,
that is what I like to
do. Now, do you think that is because, and I'm just speculating, I don't know this for a fact, he comes from a single family home where his mom is the dominant person and he's been babied.
I am the dominant person in my household.
Right, I was raised by a widowed mother, so
yes.
You know, a single mother, but she knew what a man was.
Right.
And she made us pattern after her father.
And I will say, and I hate saying that I'm a single mother because...
Well, you're a divorced
mother.
You're a divorced mother.
But geographically, he's not in the
sure,
picture.
Sure, but you're a divorced mother, which is different than
single. I'm a divorced
single, right.
But, you know, with my oldest, I was a single parent.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I was... Mm-hmm. From the very beginning, I was a single parent.
Right.
And I mean, I didn't choose to be a single parent, but it just so happened to end up that way.
Sure.
But my children have always had wonderful...
Role models.
Wonderful. I think that's...
Substitutes.
And I think that's where I've been fortunate,
mm-hmm.
is that I've always had male... I've had my family... You know,
sure.
My cousins,
stepping
my
in,
uncles,
yeah.
My grandparents.
Positive males.
I have positive, educated... You know,
mm-hmm.
and I don't mean just book smart.
Mm-hmm.
You know, educated men in my family,
mm-hmm.
that are good family men, and I'm blessed on that.
Sure, absolutely.
And I've always, you know, and that's why I'm very.
You got some handsome boys, so you got some problems coming down the pipe.
Look, my tall one has dimples.
Yes, I know.
His little chocolate cells.
Well, I was look at him, and I see his jaws. You guys have those jowls.
Yes.
So I say, yeah, that's.
I mean, I love my boys, and I'm proud of my boys, you know,
mm-hmm.
and I tell everybody, you know, my oldest son, he's on the spectrum, he's,
mm-hmm.
you know, he's high-functioning, he has
sure.
Asperger's,
mm-hmm.
and he has ADHD, but my, you know, when I learned this, we were in Okinawa,
mm-hmm.
and...
Okinawa's my hometown. Go ahead.
Okinawa, I miss it.
Yes.
I miss it.
Yes.
I miss it. I miss it. And it's
you need
just,
to go back.
I do. I need to go back, and my kids want to go back. You
okay.
know?
We need to go back and visit.
Moon Beach.
Yeah, we need to go back and visit.
I need to go, you know, I need to go have some fun.
Yeah.
But it's, for my son, it's always been a struggle.
Sure.
You know, and I've always told him that, you know, even though you are, you know, everyone is different.
Everybody's gonna be different.
No one is the same. You just have to embrace who you are.
Who you are.
And go from there.
Mm-hmm.
And
be the best you can be.
My son struggles. You know, school has always been a struggle for
sure.
him. You know,
but he made it through. That's
but
good.
He made it through, mm-hmm. and you know, my son is on. He was on an IEP, and we've gradually mm-hmm. pulled him off to where he did his. You know, he's still continuing his senior year up until July 20th, but
sure.
He's off an IEP. He's never done special ed. He's always mm-hmm. wanted to be in general ed classes
sure.
because he doesn't want anybody to typecast him
sure.
as someone that is special needs.
That's a strong kid.
Fifth grade, he decided during the summer that he didn't want to be on medication anymore. He didn't like the way it made him feel.
Mm-hmm.
So that's when we explored the natural, you know, the more Eastern
right.
medicines
mm-hmm.
where, you know, we did essential oils and we
absolutely.
Changed his diet.
Right.
And from him, I look at my son and I'm so proud of him. And, you know, mm-hmm. he's a great kid. He mm-hmm. really is a great kid.
How tall is he now? 6 feet?
6'2".
6'2".
6'2". Woo! Size 15.
There it is.
And he's a wonderful, and he's artistic, and
mm-hmm.
he's a lazy ass sometimes, but I mean, he's a
of
boy.
Course.
Whatever.
Young kid.
But my kid is, I'm proud of my kid.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm proud of how he's overcome his struggles.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that, and you know, he's never had a bad experience
sure.
in school. He's a smart, he's a popular kid.
Mm-hmm.
He's not the athletic kind because
sure.
he's a little clumsy because he's got size 15 feet.
Sure,
my
sure,
God.
Sure.
But he loves to play basketball. But
yeah.
my kids are artsy people. But
mm-hmm.
my son designs, he makes videos and designs.
Right.
Him and his friends were designing video games.
Mm-hmm.
You know, my son, he explores charcoal arts and different mediums of art. And I think that there's a lane for everybody. It just, you have to. Okay, Kevin Durant, his mom.
Yes.
Was on Good Morning America.
Wait, I want to cut you off real quick.
Uh-huh.
Thank God LeBron has finally decided to shave his head.
Oh my God.
Thank God.
I was wet because, you know.
I mean, that wasn't working, bruh.
That was just a bridge.
Yeah, that
water.
Was not working, bruh.
That is a bridge.
Now, don't get me wrong. I rock the Friar Tuck look.
No.
Which is good. It's in the back.
You know what?
It's in the back.
It's not that the fadeaway,
right? That fade,
and then putting a headband on,
right? Yeah, yeah, that ain't gonna work.
Go ahead, let go, and let God.
Mm-hmm.
Just let it go.
So I'm happy about that. But go ahead,
yeah.
Kevin Durant.
So Kevin Durant's mom was on Good Morning America.
Taking all, I mean, to me, that's just embarrassing.
And
as a man, that's embarrassing. My mom, go see. You don't see white women doing that. You don't. You really don't.
But and they asked a lot of good questions, and you know, she's like, well. And they asked, well, why, you know, because, you know, when black people are on,
mm-hmm.
Robin Roberts got stood
mm-hmm.
up, or Michael Strahan.
Mm-hmm.
So Robin Roberts asked her, why did you let your son pursue basketball? And she said, no, I actually tried to redirect him into something else.
Liar! But go ahead.
No, she says, no, I really didn't
I'll take her at a word. I'm just,
no,
I don't believe
said,
her, but.
I really don't think that basketball, she said, I didn't think that basketball was something that was going to be beneficial to him.
Mm-hmm.
Because it was him, it was Kevin and his brother. And she's like, I really tried to push them, you know, the academic group.
Okay, let me ask you this. Cut you off real quick. Do you actually believe a woman who is working what she's doing, she's got two boys that are 6-something, 7 feet tall, actually believe her sons are going to do anything other than be a payday
as
and
a
make it to the end
of a child
day?
That's 6 feet tall?
Right. Because a lot of women, that's what they do for their sons.
I did not put... And she said, I didn't push them into something that wasn't something
mm-hmm.
that they could do long term. And that's what
mm-hmm.
she was worried about.
Mm-hmm.
So when he came back and says, no, Mom, I want to play basketball.
Right.
She said, okay, but,
you
have to have the academics to back it up.
And he didn't, but go ahead.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
But, and that's what I told him. My oldest wants to be an animator and
yeah,
he wants
and
to
that's
do voiceover.
That's good.
He wanted to play basketball.
Sure.
And I said, my child. I said, here's what Mom... I said, I'm not going to sit up here and bust your butt. If that's what you want to do, fine. But you have to have the academics to back it up.
Right.
And he decided overall that in the big scheme of things, that playing sports, he
was.
Will do it for fun,
mm-hmm.
not for...
Yeah, not for long-term
right.
life.
And I know a lot of people, oh, that's horrible, that's wrong. Coming from, you know, where my uncles played professional baseball,
mm-hmm.
I knew that it's not a long-term thing. Mm-hmm. And you blow out. Nothing ever is. And I think we get stuck in, oh, well, he's going to get a $30 million contract. It's going to be this, that, and the other.
I happen to know mothers that have 3-5 boys or whatever. They have 2-4 boys. And they wait for the lottery. They're literally waiting for the lottery.
Both my cousins play baseball. Mm-hmm. One plays for San Diego, and my other cousin's over mm-hmm. at Dartmouth playing mm-hmm. baseball. And
great school, by the way.
Yes, mm-hmm. I'm so proud. Mm-hmm. What's funny was, she used to babysit me when I was a kid, mm-hmm. and I used to babysit her kids.
Okay.
And now her kids are in college, and I was like, oh my God, circle of life.
It also means you're getting older.
Yeah. But, okay, so my family is, we're part of Black society in L.A.
Sure.
And a couple weeks ago, we were in Marina Del Rey, and mm-hmm. we had privilege of handing out 12 scholarships to Black youth. And we got to...
I don't want to cut you off, but see, that's what I really admire about you, because you do a lot of stuff, and you don't tell anybody...
It's that not you're for doing
it, but that's what I'm saying. That's what I admire about
it.
Because
there's a lot of stuff I do that I don't tell people.
Yeah,
because you're not supposed to do stuff for the accolades. You're
right,
supposed to do
and I think that's very, very admirable, and I think it's very, very attractive when you're in a position that you can do those kind of things. Because I don't brag, like you said, I sponsor a young lady that's going to law school
now. That's awesome.
Yes,
and I think when I was always told, and you know, my parents. They worked hard for theirs. My aunt, mm-hmm. uncles, all that other fun stuff. So and my mom has always said I would give you the shirt off my back if you needed it.
Can you do it right? No, I'm so good.
Yes, I can. but again, it's the art of giving, and you're not doing it for the praise, for the applause. You're doing it because you are blessed to be able to give to someone else mm-hmm. who can't.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, and I do. And I have families that I sponsor, you know, mm-hmm. throughout the year and for holidays and all these other fun things. Yeah. And, you know, I do random things.
Sure.
You know, I do random things. You know, when people can't afford things.
You know, you help out.
Because I can, and I'm blessed enough to be able to give to someone else. Even if it's monetarily or mowing somebody's lawn or doing whatever. I can. You know, when I was at CBU, you know, people complained, oh, I can't afford my books, and I would mm-hmm. go buy their college books for them. If I can do that for somebody, then fine. All it is, it's, you know...
You can't take it with you at the end of the day.
Yeah, I mean, what am I going to do? You know, somebody, I don't know, I just think that to be more...
Well, to me, you know, whenever I look at you, Tay, I really think this. I say, wow, this girl is blessed, because you're in a position right now. Your kids can go to any school in California free. You retired from the military. You have a great job and probably other prospects in the future.
Hopefully, knock on wood.
And I just say, wow, this would be a top choice. It should be top choice for any guy. You know, to be with somebody, not because you got all this money or whatever. It's just that fact that you got all your shit together. Everything's lined up.
I don't think so. I think that I don't know. I don't think so. I don't know. I'm still that nerdy girl that likes to play World of Warcraft, and I watch the news all day.
And you're down home. That's what I'm saying. All your stuff is lined up. There's nothing I really have to do for you other than be a companion and a supporter.
And I'm not looking for someone to do for me. I'm looking for someone to do
with me. Exactly.
And there's a difference. I don't need a sugar daddy. I got my own. I want to know what you're bringing to the table so we can do together.
Well, there's certain things we can do together.
Here you go. Here you go.
Anyway, like I said, that was a good one. But no, seriously, this conversation is going in a great direction. Tay Wilder, Donovan Sadiq, this is Loving the Skin I'm In. I mean, we can go and hit 1,001 areas, and this is why we've got this show going. And I'm going to tell you, we are not done yet. We got another... How long can you stick around?
I'm fine. My kids.
We could do another...
I got food delivered. They're fine.
Okay, well, we could do another segment, and we're going to be back right after these messages. But, I mean... You're going exactly to what a lot of these young ladies may need to hear about, you know, they can do it on their own, but at the same time, it isn't a competition.
There isn't a competition.
You know, so... And
that's why I say I compete with no one.
All right. So, and we're going to talk about that in the second hour. Stand by.